when we read the Bible, there always has to be a purpose behind the Bible. Maybe you're going through some issue in life that you need guidance for. And you're wondering what the Bible says. Like, obviously, that's a good idea. But taking verses out of context is not a good idea. The Bible has answers for everything. It may not be super apparent. Sometimes it's just biblical principles that help guide you. But the Bible is always relevant. The Bible is always, in some way, shape, or form, will address life. So, an interpretation and application, our goal is to not take verses out of context. What that means is basically if I open up a verse and I'm like, oh, that verse sounds nice and I think it applies to my life, but it might not talk about that particular subject at all. So what's a famous example? A famous example might be, actually, I can't remember. My mind is blanking out, but if I think of an example, I will let you know. I guess ask and you receive. Okay. Some people they like taking that verse out of context. They just say, oh, well, you ask God and like, he's going to give it to you. I think that's a very immature. Sorry. Apparently that was Mary Had a Little Lamb from Stevie Vaughn. So some people will take that verse out of context, ask and you receive. They think it just applies to anything, you know, but there's no like requirements of what to ask. Or you might hear that from a health and wealth preacher who might say, ask and you receive, but give me some money first. Those types of verses get used out of context so much. But as a person who, or as a class, if we were to study that passage, it's not just ask whatever you want. So when we look at the Bible, we try our best to not take verses out of context. We always want to focus on what the author says, what the author's intent is, in order to get a better understanding of what the Bible is actually conveying. So, what's the point of Bible study? The point of Bible study is growth. Knowing God. I mean, there could be so many things. Today, I want to focus on this just for a short bit. We're going to go John 15, 8. Can I have you read John 15, 8, please?
It says, by this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, and so prove to be my disciples.
Okay, so this verse is pretty self-explanatory. I think it's always better to look at the overall context. But there are some verses that aren't as straightforward. I feel like this one is kind of straightforward. But we should always be looking at the overall context. So when you look at the overall context, they're talking about the vine. And so that's where the bearing fruit comes. And so if you abide in Christ, who is the true vine, you will bear fruit. Anyone who does not bear fruit is not of Christ. And so in this verse, he says, or let me start at verse 7. If you abide in me and my words abide in you,
ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. So I think when it comes to ask whatever you wish and it'll be done for you, that is probably a verse taken out of context. But if you look at it more, if you abide, if you are in accord with Christ, you will likely ask what Christ desires and not what you desire. And I think that's the difference. If you really abide in Christ and the Christ's words abide in you, you will bear fruit based off of what Christ desires, and you will ask for what Christ is, what also Christ desires. So in verse 8, he says, "By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, and so prove to be my disciples." When I take you to this verse, I want to focus on glorify. The concept of glory, what it does anybody have an idea of what glory means? Ian?
It's like recognition, kind of praise.
Okay. So let me write it like this. What is glory? Praise is what you said, right?
Yeah.
Praise, recognition. Phoebe, what do you think glory means? Or give me an idea. When you think of glory, what do you think? Huh? Respect? I think in a way, yes. That'd be nice. What? Okay. Alana, what do you think? Okay, praise. All right, so we'll stop there. The concept of glory. Some people think it's like this radiance. Okay. That radiance is more of a weightiness. But what is that weightiness? I think when we generally speak about God's glory, we speak about who he is. Who he is weighty. Like when you think of Kobe. Okay, Kobe, the basketball player, I think you should all know him. If you don't know him, then okay, we'll just use LeBron. Even the Kobe is so much better. If LeBron or Kobe walked into a room, everyone would just shut up, right? I mean, I think even Hanley, if he were preaching Sunday service and LeBron or Kobe walked in, he's more enamored with Kobe, not so much LeBron. But anyway, which I think is rightfully so. But anyway, if he walked in, one of those two walked in, do you think Hanley would stop his sermon? Do you think Hanley would pause? I think so. I think he'd be like, what the, like, what is going on? There's a presence about them. It's what they've done. It's who they are. But imagine if, like, that's a humanistic example. But imagine God. And you get this understanding of why in Isaiah 6, Isaiah thought he was going to die. There's this weightiness about God, about his character. And this glory is that it's his reputation. It's his praise. It's the reason why we respect somebody. So the recognition, we can also say that in glory, and I'm just going to get nerdy on you, is this means glory, fame, majesty. And so when you think of glory, I want you to think of fame. Okay, this is the Greek writing, whatever. It's doxa, the same thing as doxology. When we give praise to God, you say the doxology. So you can think of it like that.
But when we think about glory, I want you to think about praise. And when you think about praise, I want you to think about magnifying the name of God. So God has his own glory. Okay. Does he really need us to glorify him? I don't think so. God is perfectly glorious because it is who he is. So when we go back to verse 8, Jesus is saying, by this, my Father is glorified. By this, my Father is made known. His fame increases. His majesty increases. Like, we magnify God. That you bear much fruit. Does that start to make sense? By this, my Father is glorified. By this, my Father's reputation is magnified, that you bear fruit. And in that sense, the more you bear fruit, the more you look like God, or you take on the character of God as much as possible, even though we are sinners. And through God changing us, through God helping us to bear fruit, our lives magnify God. Okay. Does that make sense? All right. So he says, by this my Father is glorified, or in this my Father is glorified. You can by or in is same here. That you bear much fruit, and so prove to be my disciples. The reason why I chose this verse is when you go to college, and you may not be set in a fellowship, or you might not have a church yet. Sometimes the only thing you can do is read your Bible. And so far, since January, we've only gone through how to read certain genres. Today, I want to focus on interpretation, and this is where we're actually going to help you to understand, after you've read it, understand what questions should be asked, how we should translate those biblical principles from back then in its original context to today's original context. So that the Bible is not just something that is head knowledge. The Bible then becomes something that is absolutely true in your heart and something that is livable. So when it says, by this or in this, my Father is glorified, which is equating the next phrases, that you bear much fruit and prove to be my disciples. When you bear fruit, you look more, I think you're taking on the qualities of God, such as the fruits of the Spirit, and also proving to be disciples. When you go into college, some of you or many of you may doubt your faith. Okay. I think high school is easy for you. High school, your parents bring you to youth group. You guys have youth group every Friday. You guys come to Sunday school. You guys are kind of limited in what you guys can do. When you go off into college away from your parents, you're going to have this freedom. And that freedom, to me, in my opinion, is where your faith is tested. And some of you guys may say, I don't know if I'm saved anymore because I really like some of these things that I shouldn't be doing. And once you come to that understanding, there are some people who will just say, oh, forget it. I don't want to go to church at all. And then there are some of you who might be like, I don't think this is right. I shouldn't be doing this. And I think that's the Holy Spirit working in your lives to help you bear fruit. Some people like me might need to like do bad things and receive the consequences. Some of you are more smarter than me, or actually a lot of you are smarter than me, and may not need that. But when you go off into college, the idea that I'm trying to present to you now is to bear fruit. And if you bear fruit, then you know you're saved. Even if you don't have a college fellowship, or even if you're like in another state and you're trying to look for churches, but you don't feel like a church is, or you haven't found a church that you want to be at yet, you can always read the Bible for yourself and do a study. It's not as conducive for your spiritual life to be apart from the church, though. But in your time of transition, I think this is something that you should hold on to, which is Bible study. Okay, so that's the reason why I presented John 15:8 to you. I want you to understand that the Bible is not just head knowledge, but it is something real. It is something living. It is something that will bear fruit for you. So now that we've gone through that, let's go to interpretation. Interpretation, I've mentioned it before. I'm going to use a different marker. All right. Interpretation. Interpretation. There are two questions to ask. All right. The first question and the second question. Actually, who knows? Arissa, you've been here. What have I said in the past about interpretation? Like, what's the question that we're asking?
What does this mean?
Close.
What was the original meaning that the original author intended for the original audience?
Okay. Yes. How do we put it in a shorter way? What is the author's intent? All right, so that's the main question that we're asking. What is the author's intent? Before you can ask, what does this mean to me, you need to ask, what is the author trying to say? The reason being is because when you go off into college, there's going to be so many people that throw different ideas out at you. There's also going to be a lot of different applications of the text thrown out at you. But how do you decipher when you go to a new church that their interpretation is accurate? Because as a Sunday school teacher, my desire is that you go to church, but my true desire is that you find a church that teaches the word accurately. If you don't find a church that teaches its word accurately, then you might just be learning different principles that could, it might not be bad, but I don't think that it would be as impactful on your spiritual life. So I really hold, or we as FCBC hold to a high view of scripture, and we hope that that remains with you. So before you ask, what does this mean to me? You must ask, what is the author's intent? And to understand the author's intent is the hardest part. After that, everything is fairly simple. I'm not going to say it's absolutely simple, but it's fairly simple. So the next thing that we want to do is, and I'm going to leave a gap over here, actually. Then you want to ask, what is the big idea? Okay. And I'm using the word and the concept of big idea because our church uses it. When you are sitting in the sermon, I don't know if Kevin does this, but I know Hanley does it. At the end of the sermon, or you know that the end of the sermon is coming up because they say, this is the big idea. How many of you guys have caught on to that? Okay. If you're super tired and you're falling asleep during the sermon, I'm not gonna judge you or anything like that. I've had that happen to me. The biggest, most important part of the sermon that you should be taking note of is the big idea. The big idea is, I would say, the central part of the author's intent. But the big idea is like the one principle that the that the preacher wants to give to you. It should be one principle. Ideally, it's like one main principle that helps you cross from the author's intent, meaning the author's historical context, and then it'll help you bring it to application. So, number three, I would say, is the application part. So I'll say application. What does this number three application, what does this mean for me or us? It's taking this big idea that we've received from the author's intent. The big idea is kind of your main principle of the passage, and then you apply it to today's context. So ideally, that is your interpretive process all the way to application. Sometimes the Bible, when you read the passage, it's very straightforward. What it means back then, or what it was in its historical context back then, is the same for us today. But sometimes, actually a lot of times, it's not quite like that. So for instance, when we talk about in Revelation, suffering and pain, and the fact that persecution will come, how many of you guys have ever experienced persecution and suffering and pain at the hands of people that are actively against God? Probably not many of us. So, if I were preaching something in Revelation, I'm not going to, like, if I'm preaching it to you guys, I'm not going to preach that you are going through suffering and persecution. I might have to spend some time to actually think about your current context and how that might show up. It might show up in like a lesser form of persecution, like if you're in the sense that you're not, your life's not on the line for your faith, but if you choose to stand up for your faith, let's say in the context of your friends. Okay. In the context of your friends, like they want to go smoke weed or whatever, they want to drink, do underage drinking. And you say, no, I don't want to do that. Well, then they might think, okay, you're not cool. You're kind of boring. We're not going to hang out with you. And they're not going to be friends. Is that a form of persecution? Yeah, I would say so. It could be. And I think if you did that, yeah, you would lose friends. I know I have lost friends because I haven't, you know, I refuse to do those things. Or some of the things that they decided to do. They don't invite me to everything, which is fine. But they know where I stand. And so sometimes the context, the historical context back then does not match today. But it just takes some time to think about it. So, author's intent. This is what I want to do. We're going to look at, or does anybody have any questions so far? I want us to look at Acts 20. I think it's, 8 to 12. All right, so we've gone through this passage before. I've pretty much just taught it to you guys. In groups, so I'm finally having a group thing. Okay, so we'll just
we'll just be segregationists. The guys will be one group. From Arissa to Phoebe, you guys will be another group, and then you four, you guys just come to the stable. which is how it works out. You all sit by gender. That's how you know you're true FCBC. You default to gender, sitting by your gender. It's fine. All right. I want you to take Acts 20, 8 to 12, and I want you guys to discuss it. And I want you to answer these questions. Okay. So what is the author's intent? What's the big idea? And the application. Like, how would you... I want you to think of how you, in your current context, so high school, or maybe it might be a family matter, would apply Acts 20, 8 through 12. Now, what I'm really looking for is the big idea. A big idea, and before we actually start this, a big idea is ideally one sentence. Not necessarily a list. It's practically a summarization. So the author's intent, you want to stick with what the text generally says. So let's just say John 3:16, right? The author's intent is to show God's love, or I would say John's intent, right? John is the author. Let me start over. If I were to take John 3:16 and I want to put it in a simple sentence, it's almost like just summarizing John 3:16 because it's pretty straightforward. It's basically something like God shows his love to believers through the sacrifice of Jesus Christ on the cross to give us eternal life. Like, it's a quick summarization. But the big idea would be God shows his love through sacrifice. Something like that. Okay. It's more focusing on that one major principle in that verse. And then application might be a little bit different. Okay. So that's how I want you to answer it. What's the author's intent? Generally, one sentence. What is the big idea? It's one sentence as well, but it's just focusing primarily on that one idea. And then application doesn't need to be one sentence, but I want you to try your best in your group to figure out the context for you and how that would apply.